everybody. Thank you so much for coming on this beautiful Sunday afternoon to the Cowles Center for Dance and the Performing Arts. My name is Michelle Steinwald, and today is the 10th talk we're doing as part of a series called Minnesota Dance and the Ecstasies of Influences. This is when we get to talk about all the people in our communities that have influenced us to... Oh, that's my parking. That's really embarrassing. Okay, let me just... So I know. Okay, for history, everybody knows I got parking outside. Okay, so 10th talk. This is the third year we do this series, and every talk we do, we have it mapped by our resident chronicler, calligrapher, mapping, Kristen Van Loon, our mapping goddess and local choreographer, will be mapping the conversation. And so it's really beautiful how we get to see how everybody is connected and how our worlds overlap. Behind us, I hung the first of every year. So on the bottom, the history of contact improvisation in the Twin Cities was the first talk we ever did. That was in 2014. Right above it, the history of tap dance in the Twin Cities, 2015, and the one we just did on Remembering Prince just a couple months ago. So I'm gonna turn over today to our host, Maia Maiden, the founder and curator for Rooted.
Hello. How's everybody doing? Good? So we're here to talk about the history of Rooted, and there have been a lot of performers in Rooted. I'm going to name all of them, you know, throughout the series. But first of all, the goal here is not to give you the history of hip-hop. We can do that another day. This is our history within hip-hop, so we're trying to build relationships. Who knows who inspired who, how long we've been dancing, the style of hip-hop that we do. Is that okay with you guys? Okay. So first, in order for me to talk about my journey through hip-hop, I need to play this song because it's so crucial to my life and how I started in hip-hop.
You ready for the song?
Okay. So, this is Kid and Play, okay? House Party. House Party is a definite turning point in my life in terms of hip-hop. So this is where, this is what I wanted to do. This style of dance, under the umbrella of hip-hop, all the old school moves that you see, everything, yes, that's where I came from. So I represent old school 90s, late 80s hip-hop. So that's kind of where I came in with Kid and Play. So that's always been an inspiration to me. So I just wanted to give you a little taste of kind of where I came from. So I grew up in South Minneapolis, Southside, all day. Graduated from Apple Valley, went to the University of Minnesota, have several degrees, but I am hip-hop, right? Several. So, who inspired me? I've been dancing since forever. I started off in West African dance and was always doing hip-hop dance. There were no classes. We didn't go to school and learn class in hip-hop. This is something we did every day because that's what we do, okay? I grew up on the box. Anybody know about the box? The box is old school. People would play, pay money to pay, watch videos, music videos, so like Mary J. Blige, when she first came out, all the videos that we used to wait and wait for the video to come on. And that's how we would learn the dance moves. Seriously, that's how we would learn it, right? Somebody relates to that. So the box came out, and that's kind of where I learned all of my dance moves. And just dancing just all over Minneapolis. We would battle in school. Okay, I went to Anthony Junior High School. We would battle there. I mean, it was a real deal. It was really serious. We would practice and rehearse to battle in junior high school. I mean, nobody told us to do it. This is what we were doing. So just stemming from there, okay? And so I've also been in the genre of West African, which is one of the roots of hip-hop. And so just doing that, my major influences were Patricia Brown, Morris Johnson, Roxanne Wallace, Gisele Mason. Those were kind of my key components in teaching me just dance in general, right? They were not necessarily hip hop, but those are my foundational people. So I'd like to give a shout out to those particular people because those are people that influenced me even today. So I can call one of them up, and these people are, they're a big deal. But I can call them and be like, hey, what do you think about this? They're always telling me still what to do 20 some years later. okay? So that's kind of how I started off in hip hop dance. So the stories we're gonna hear today, specifically, you know, they're gonna talk about their entry into Rooted, but Rooted started in 2009, okay? And that came from just a lack of hip hop dance on Minnesota theaters and stages. Not to say it's gotten tremendously better, but it's a little bit better than 2009. So that's where this started, because there was a lot of times where we would get an opportunity as a hip hop community to be on stage, but it'd be one of us, okay? And we all don't do the same thing. Hip hop is multifaceted, just like modern is multifaceted, just like ballet is multifaceted. So it would be one of us that would get the hip hop spot, and a lot of times that would not go to a person of color. So after many years of this, I said, you know what? I'm gonna do my own choreographer's evening. Get all the people that need to be recognized, need to be represented. And from there, it just flourished. The community really took a hold of it. I only planned on doing it 1 year. I only planned on doing it once. And so when I first thought about doing it, I was like, let me ask some people. I asked Jason Noir, I asked Anika McMullen. I was like, you think this would work? They're like, yeah, you should do it. So from there, it just kept growing. The first year of Rooted, there were like 350 people there. 350 people sold, I mean, in Patrick's Cabaret, which is super small, right? And it really only seats like 60 or 70 people. 350 people sold out, lines out the door around the block for Rooted. And I said, okay, I think I'm gonna do this again. Let me think about it, because these people are driving me crazy right now, but that's what happened. So there is kind of where Rooted started from. So we're still here, just celebrated 50 year anniversary this year, and we just plan on going. So I want to go ahead and get started and start introducing people and let them speak about themselves. First on the mic, we have Herbert Johnson, okay? And he's gonna come talk about his experience.
Okay, all right. So my name is Herb Johnson, or Herbert Johnson. I am originally from Chicago. I moved here 2005, and that is sort of where my dancing history began. I moved here, I went to Nellie Stone Johnson for the eighth grade, and then once I graduated out of the eighth grade, I went to North High School. In North Minneapolis, and that is where I started dancing. My dancing started from, there was this one guy who was like the known dancer at the high school. His name was Rob, last name unknown. And so from there, I tried to introduce myself because I didn't really know anyone here. And from there, I started dancing out of a conversation that me and him had. Through that, me, him, and some other dancers, there's a guy named James. His nickname is Disney. He would teach me popping. And then there was another guy at our high school. His name was B-Boy B. And he would teach me breaking. And so we would spend our lunchtime in the cafeteria dancing. We would borrow a boombox from the dance program at North High School, and we would bring it down to the cafeteria, and then we'd dance. We'd battle each other, everything. And then towards the end of my freshman year, I started to teach other people, specifically Robert King, a lot of other people, a friend named Romar, a friend named LA, and we all just came together as a group. The style that we really started to do was Crump. Crump is an acronym for Kingdom Radically Uplifting Mighty Praise. And so we started to Crump, and we began to hear that there were other groups of Crumpers in other areas. There were Crumpers at Hopkins High School. There were Crumpers at Columbia Heights High School and Cooper High School. And they were, oh, and Edison High School as well. And then for us, it was Henry High School, North High School, and South High School. So we were all a crew, and then all of those other high schools were one crew. They went by the name Unfound. We had a performance at the Capri Theater, and that's where we—that's where the both groups collide. We had an epic duel, and my crew failed miserably. And from that point, they inspired us to really push ourselves because we weren't at that advanced level that they were at the time. Moving forward, once I got into my sophomore year, I started to expand out into different communities other than the Crump community that I was that I was involved in, and so. I started to dance with James Disney a lot more, and that's sort of where I started to hear about Dancing Dave and started to see videos of Dancing Dave and Disney battling Dancing Dave. And that's when I started to want to know more about popping. And so Disney would teach me popping in the cafeteria. Then there were auditions at our school for a crew called Epiphany. That group was led by Javaris, last name unknown right now, Thomas. I said that in my mind, but then I was like, is that somebody else? You know. Javaris Thomas, and I did that. That was choreography, and actually Epiphany and Alan's crew, Immortal, we were rivals. And so we would always do these choreography competitions, and then we'd see them and they'd see us and we'd be like, yeah. So after doing Epiphany, I joined a group called the Hood Nerds. the Hood Nerds was a group that focused on showing how kids in an urban area can be intelligent and do positive things in their community. So we would do a lot of volunteer work, teaching at elementary schools, we would even put on parties at the Roller Gardens or Cheapskate. And yeah, those are the fun times. And then we would perform at those parties. Through Hood Nerds, that sort of inspired me to really reach out even further into different, into a different scene. And so I then got involved in a crew called Obtuse Crew. And that was led originally by Josh Stevens. Actually meeting him was, I think, was the turnaround of, like, how I started to dance because at the time he was, like, really, really dope and he was way, like, crazier than I was at dance. And so I was like, man, like, I gotta step my game up and, like, this dude is tight. And they asked me to be a part of their crew. I was honored. We did a lot of performances. And then Obtuse Crew became rivals of Immortal, Alan's crew. So no matter where I was, we were rivals. It didn't really matter. But it wasn't like mean rival. It was all love. And so with Obtuse Crew, we began doing a bunch of performances, dancing at the Minnesota Music Awards, doing fashion shows, performing at fashion shows, and eventually Obtuse Crew sort of dispersed because everyone started to grow up and get into the things that they really wanted to get into. So I then created my own crew called Deadpool with a friend of mine named Darian. This is after I graduated high school. In 2010, and so we created a crew called Deadpool, and that started off as a choreography crew. We auditioned for some things, and we performed at some places. We did drop the mic, out of that, the choreography group became a freestyle group. And so the difference between choreography and freestyle is you just do it off the top of your head versus learning something and then everybody's doing the same thing. So with Deadpool, it became a freestyle crew, and then we started to battle everywhere. We started to go to places out of state, and that is where I started to bring everything that I had gathered together. The things that I gathered together came from people like Dancing Dave, Jay Sun, Maia Maiden, actually All Day. All Day. and the breaking community here at large, the popping community here at large, just the community overall is sort of what got me to bring everything together. And then I brought Crump back into it. During that time, I moved away from Crump because I was trying to expand it. And so now that it has expanded, other than that, I've just been doing what I can, and I've just been connecting with people. I've been just doing my part, other than that. And then I was in Rooted. I auditioned for Rooted, like, I don't know what, I forgot what year, but I just know Maia Maiden was looking at us, and she was like, no, not this year, so... That made me push harder, and that made the rest of us push harder, and then we came back, and then mm-hmm. we out here. We enrooted.
Yeah. So, yeah. Thank you, Herb.
Yep.
Okay, so as we get ready, Tamiko French is going to come up. We're going to keep up with the high school theme going on. Next after Tamiko, we're going to do El Tawam in the building. We're going to do She after that. So, Tamiko, go ahead. And we're going to try to keep everything to about 2 minutes, guys. Okay. So, talk to
I'll
us
do my best.
About
okay.
North High.
All right. So, my name is Tamiko French. I am a proud Northsider, born and raised. Yes, I followed the chain. So, I went from Hall to Franklin to North High School. I started dancing in an after-school program when I was at Hall Elementary with my gym teacher, and she was a South African woman. And she said, you know what? You have a really awesome gift. I saw you do gymnastics. I saw you in gym. I want you to dance. And I was scared to death. And she put me in this grass skirt and this little top, and she had me doing South African dance. And then she said, you know what? Try this after-school program with hip-hop. So a choreographer came in, and he taught us routines from Janet Jackson and Paula Abdul. And he happened to be a choreographer for Janet Jackson and Paula Abdul, and at that time, Janet Jackson was here. So we had a really interesting connection with that choreographer. And we performed a few times, and I realized at that moment that I wanted to be Janet Jackson, and that's what I was going to do. I still didn't take professional classes because I couldn't afford it. So it was kind of a dream deferred. I did a lot of talent shows, worked with my friends, did, you know, in the basement. I originally started hip-hop, hardcore, when I was, like, probably 5 with my brother. That was my initial inspiration. So I was spinning on my head when I was, like, 5 and started breaking and locking with him. And not that I was excellent at it at that time. But as I grew and started really having influences with the choreographers in the area, and we were lucky to have an arts program that reached into the school, when I got into 8th grade, I did a hula hoop routine to Janet Jackson, All Right. And that was when I kind of realized, for real, this is probably what I want to do. Because I had 7 hula hoops going, and everybody was on their feet, and I was dancing, doing our social dances in there. And I was like, okay, yeah, this is what I want to do. And then the dance teacher from North High came in, and she's like, well, you should sign up. And so when I signed up, I was 100% ready to go. Got to freshman year, 3 months of training, and got exposed to my first audition as a freshman with Baba Chuck Davis. African dance master, African American dance ensemble in Durham, North Carolina. And it was a big deal. Everyone from all over the city came. There was about 150 people in our dance room at North High. And Colleen Callahan Russell was my teacher. At that time, with 3 months of training, I received that audition, and I was actually a teen leader. So that was my first professional gig at 14 years old. And that probably is the initial point, yes. So I worked with just about everybody in the city. So the same names, Giselle Mason, Roxanne Wallace, Morris Johnson, Tony Pierce from Wilhelmina Taylor, Garth Fagan's group, Catherine Dunham. They just brought anybody who came in was here when this was the Dance Alliance here. June Wilson brought me into her company, and I got a chance to work with Monque and Dulce and Marae Regulus and people that are staple organizers in the community. And so the African influence is really strong in my work. I would say that my core is old school hip hop. 80s hip-hop, 90s hip-hop, and then also this layer of street jazz funk. Janet Jackson is a huge influence, so that layered into that. So I do a very interesting fusion style. And being a trained dancer, you merge what you learn. So ballet, jazz, modern. And I've been teaching ever since I was about 14, I'd say, in choreography. I had choreography in the Young People's Choreographers Evening, if you remember. That used to be down here, actually. And did pieces with my group that I started when I was 16, Essence of Ebony. And that toured for 2 years. And we did Mill City Music Festival. We used to do background dance for Tina Arredondo, if you remember Tina Arredondo. And a lot of things. And in 17, I went to Temple University, got my bachelor's, came back every year at North High School, every year that I could teach. And produced a lot of their shows all up until about 2004, 2005, and took some hip-hop choreography to New York and did Project Dance. So I featured some North High dance artists at Project Dance. So it's been an interesting ride. I was gone for about 15 years, coming back, was able to work with Maia coming out straight out the gate, Kenna Cotman with various projects with Kenna and with North High volunteering, and now I'm the dance director at North High School, and involving them in Rooted was a joy, and Maia invited me for that, and just allowing the kids to experience dance in through a lens that is non-judgmental, allows them to be themselves, allows them to create an area for voice, social justice issues that are going on with them, versus really sticking to a true break kind of style. I let them merge their own voice in there, just like I had the ability to do. So it's really a joy and an honor to bring that to the stage. And that's what the connection in Rooted, as you can see, they were very, very about dealing with the issue at hand, which at that time was shootings that are going on over North. So near and dear to my heart, that's what I do. Hip hop is definitely my root in my life, and I love doing what I do.
Thank you, Tamiko. El Tawam, and she, you want to come up here too, because we're gonna do a collaborative thing going on here. So in the theme, yes, in the theme of it's high school. Not saying everybody's up here in high school, but they look young, don't they? They look fantastic. So, first of all, she and everybody's not here, but she just won a SAGE Award, the last SAGE Award for Outstanding Ensemble out of Rooted. Just saying. Rooted has, I would say, as a side note, out of the, I would say, eight groups, people who have been nominated in the SAGE Awards. SAGE Awards is the only dance awards in Minnesota. Out of eight people I would house under hip hop, the roots of hip hop type thing going on, five have came out of Rooted. Five out of eight. Yeah. So just putting everything out there, but these particular people are fantastic. I'm just going to sit down. First, we're going to do El Tawam and just roll into She. Thank you.
All right. Well, my name is Khadija Saifalaw Griffin. My name is Iman. And we are partners in crime. Our dancing, Iman and I, started from our home. Our parents would always play the music that they listened to, hip-hop, of course, a lot of calypso, soca, reggae, dancehall, and hip-hop, like I said. So we'd watch movies like Break-In and Beat Street, like it was Barney, like just every day, always watching that and copying what we saw. And when my mother realized that we had rhythm, she taught us how to put together an 8-count, and we made our first dance from there. And then it was after that that we started doing like birthday parties and little small things. And she wanted to take our dancing a step further. So she found Xenon, and we came to Amira Sackett's class, a dancer who was in the hip hop community. And she was just so amazed at our ability and at the fact that we were Muslim. So from there, we started We're Muslim, Don't Panic, which was a dance created in 2012 for the joint project. It was to bring awareness about Muslim women in our traditional clothing, and we won a SAGE Awards for that. So after that, Iman and I decided that we wanted to get back into focusing on ourselves, and that brought us to Sister Solo. And that was our first performance, just us two in the community. From that point, just could continue dancing, meeting dancers. And then we realized that there weren't enough women and girls in the dance community, especially our own age. And we were tired of going to battles and ciphers and like being the only girl. So we got the idea to form an all women and girls collective. And that's what we have now, She, which stands for She Who Holds Everything. So anything you want to say before I let them introduce themselves?
And what grade are you guys in now currently?
We are seniors at Southwest High School.
Seniors, Southwest, getting ready to graduate. Yay.
Yes.
All right.
I'm ready. Hello. So yeah, Khadija basically said everything. We're twin sisters, so of course, brought up in the same household, listening to the same music. Kind of what Tamika was saying, at that time, our parents could not afford to put us in the studio. And so with that being the situation, that's like one of the reasons why like I held like hip hop so near and dear to my heart, because it was accessible to me. And as I got older, well, up until like the age of 8, you know, it was just something done at home. But at the age of 8, just starting to realize this is an actual thing, this is an actual culture. And at the age of 13, when we started to become part of productions, reading about it, meeting people like Maia, Kenna Cotman, that not only, you know, talk to us about hip-hop and hip-hop dance, but also the feeling behind it, and how much hip-hop, how much it means. So yeah, I love it so much. Fast forward, like Khadija said, with She, just being able to not only further my journey, but also do it with these other young ladies. And this year was, I believe, our third time, Khadija and I's third time being in Rooted. And then this year being the first time performing with them. And Rooted is always a welcoming environment, and getting to meet people in the community, and being able to do it with these ladies this year just really, it was just the best. So let them talk.
Thank you.
This is gonna go down.
Come on, work it, Ashley, work it. Come on.
Okay, hi, my name's Ashley Tao. I'm 19, full-time student at the U.
Yes.
I started dancing at a rec center at Arlington High School, and from there, the teacher recommended me to go to a studio, so I did studio for about 8 years at Larkin Dance Studio in Maplewood, and it just became tiring and expensive. So I stopped there and I went to SPCPA, St. Paul Conservatory for Performing Artists, where I met a lot of my friends that I have now. There, Herb was my hip hop teacher, which you met earlier, and he really got me into the community, you know, going to jams, session, all that. And then I saw Shapeshift, which El Tuam was also in, and then I saw that they were holding auditions for She, and I was like, well, I don't really have a dance family right now, and like, it'd be great to like be part of something, you know, something in the community. So I auditioned and I got in, and it was like a great feeling. So I'm fairly new to the hip hop community, you know, dabbling in house and crump and whacking, all that fun stuff. Yeah, so that's my dance life.
Thank you.
I'm Mia Johnson, and I started dancing in my living room when I was like 9 years old, solely because of Michael Jackson. And that was how I got started dancing, was learning every Michael Jackson video I possibly could. And somehow the universe worked it out to about a year after that, a local Michael Jackson tribute here was looking for kids to be in one of their dances. And that tribute's called Legacy, a tribute to the King of Pop, and Alan, who's right there, is in it too.
Yes.
And so that was like my first time meeting people in this community. Herb talked about Josh Stevens. I met him then as well. And that was kind of my first look into hip hop styles. And so I just focused on hip hop choreography for a while. And then I started going to SPCPA, and Herb was my teacher there. And that was my first time with looking at the styles through more of a freestyle view instead of choreography. And so lately I've been training in crump under Herb, and so that would be the main style that I've been working on lately. And I also got the opportunity, Mona Lisa, okay, there we go, teaches at SPCPA now. And so I got to take her breaking class for a semester. And so that was a new experience for me too. And so just getting out in the community through Herb is how I met these lovely ladies and found out about the She auditions and kind of met everyone here. And then I got into She while also doing stuff with Alan through just some choreography, and did some stuff with his group Immortal as well. And so I've been able to hang on to both the freestyling stuff that I've gotten from Herb as well as some of the choreography aspects that sticking around with Alan, and then I got to be a part of She, and here I am.
All right.
Okay, so I wrote mine down.
Mic down for her. Thank you.
Okay. There we go.
All right.
So, hi, my name is Bella Roberts. I also go by B-Girl Illa and Tiny Caution. I love all urban styles of dance, crump, breaking, Chicago footwork, and house are my favorites. I started dancing in a competition studio. I took a breaking class with Swells. I studied breaking, attended battles, and then I wanted to learn all urban styles of dance. My biggest influences in dance are my coaches Herbert Johnson, Daylight, Damian Day, Budilla, John King, and Wicked, Eric Delgado. I want to travel the world and meet other dancers. I want to be a teacher someday and inspire others, especially girls like my coaches have inspired me. I want to design my own shoe and clothing line and write a children's book on the history of hip hop. This was my first year in Rooted. I was one of the youngest cast members ever. I wanted to dance with, I danced with my shoe sisters and in a crump freestyle. Mm-hmm. Here I am.
All right, Bella.
I just want to point out that she is the youngest to ever win a SAGE award. So let's clap.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody. My name is Destiny Anderson. I will say I started dancing in my living room as well, watching videos. I distinctly remember watching Sierra's 1-2 Step featuring featuring Missy Elliott, and that being like my real beginning. Like, I just continued watching videos, like watching movies, Step Up, You Just Got Served, like all different hip hop movies, and getting inspired by the movement. And my parents soon noticed that I was just dancing all around the house, and I got put into an after-school program at the MLK Center in St. Paul, and I did hip-hop there for a little bit. And I soon stopped, and then there was like a period of time that I didn't really do any dancing at any studios or any with anybody else, so I just kept dancing in my house and looking at videos. And my parents, not my parents, I'm trying to think. I got into high school, and I got accepted into 2 Dance Center, where I got a full ride scholarship and could get trained in ballet, modern, and West African. My West African teacher is Kenna Cotman, ballet teacher Abdo Saeed, and modern teacher Tony Pierce-Sands and Duncan Schultz. And so a lot of those people started to cultivate all the dancing that I had and started to train. I remember being in my first ballet class and hating it. And not feeling like it was natural to my body. And soon learning that I could take where I began and like all of that and put it into something. I also went to SVCPA where Herbert Johnson was my hip hop teacher, and also Mona Lisa was my hip hop teacher, a breaking teacher as well. So those two people were where I started to get back into the hip hop community, where I started to meet all of these people. In that school and in that area, going to 2 Dance and being able to do projects with different choreographers. And soon after being able to be a part of SHE, I saw Imani Khadija all throughout the dance community, first seeing them at Sister Solo and just being amazed and getting to know them later on. And they told me about the SHE auditions and I actually missed it, but I got to send in a video and I'm so blessed for that. And I soon found out that I was accepted. And I just remember like doing our first performance. We were at the Target Center performing for Brother Ali. And that just seemed like the craziest thing in the world, but it was amazing. And I give a lot of thanks to them. And then I found out we were doing Rooted, and I didn't really know much about Rooted because I wasn't that into the hip hop community. And once I found out that we were doing it and once I was there with all of the people, like it truthfully changed my understanding of what hip hop can do and like all that it does for everybody on a daily. It's truthfully changed my life, and it is a root of mine. Whenever people ask me what I'm trained in, I always tell them I started doing hip hop. Like always, that's my beginning. I started to learn African, and then ballet, modern, all of this comes soon after, because when you start with your root, you can't, and you know all these other things, you can bring that together. And I think I'm gonna dance for the rest of my life, and I can thank hip hop for that.
So. All right, yes. Yes. All right. Yeah. So thank you guys. Up next, Vasti, you want to come up here? So we keep it in line with people in high school. We got quite a few of those people. So.
So you want to tell us your name? What school do you go to? And how did you get started?
Okay. Here we go.
Oh, I'm nervous. My name is Vasti Anna, and I'm a sophomore at Henry High. I've been dancing for like my whole life, back in Cameroon. So I've been here for actually almost 4 years. So I started dancing by doing little Sunday school dances in church and school programs, traditional dances at school. And yeah, I mostly did Afrobeat. So I listened to people like Davido and P-Square and all those other people, and mostly Western African dances. Yeah, so from there, during primary school, secondary school, I join every dancing show I could, dancing performances I could, did choreographies with my friends, and yeah, I learned a lot from them, and we just kind of help each other. And then I moved here, which is like 2013, I think, joined the after-school program in my middle school, and then high school, which was last year, I got introduced to the dance community here in Minnesota during the dance battle, but then I didn't actually get to interact really well till I was introduced to Rooted by Jason, who was my break dance teacher. And yeah, I got to meet awesome people. It really felt like a community, and I've never really felt more welcome in a place. Being my first time there and meeting new faces, got to meet Mai, got to really talk to a ton, both of them, meet everybody, Herb. And yeah, now I'm still taking classes with Jason and Dave, and just trying to improve my dancing, try to expand and try to learn other dances apart from Afrobeat, and got introduced to popping, b-boy, b-girl dancing, and yeah, here we are today.
Awesome. So I just want to read, so Rooted has been 2009, 2010, then I said, I can't do this every year. So then I started doing it every other year. So 2012, 14, and 16. So in 2012, we had Amira Sackett, Art of Dance, B-Boy J Sun and Dancing Dave, Christ Up, which is was a crump group conformed of J, Tone, there's so many people in there, DeAndre, right? From the Streets to Stage, which is Renee Thompson. We had Hip Hope, we had Hannah and Jay, Lily Stone, Midwest Kingdom, which again, Crump was in 2012, so it's just amazing how they come, but they circle around. Then we had Minnesota Funk Styles, and now they're known as All Day. All Day. So we're gonna have All Day up here. Come on up, guys, while I finish reading. Mm-hmm. So we had All Day, we had Rhythm Tappers, we had Obtuse Crew. And so Obtuse Crew, you heard about Joshua Stevens, Lulu Champion. So we had Obtuse Crew. They won the first stage awards in terms of hip hop in 2012. We had Oyin, we had Praxis, which was Patrick Henry High School with Jason. We had Tempest, and we had Voice of Culture. So right now, we have the Funk Stylists All Day. Tracy, you want to start us off, please? All Day.
Yeah, All Day, All Day. So All Day is actually short for Minnesota All Day. So, what to say? Well, listening to you high schoolers, I feel really, really old. I'm like, dang, I ain't old. I'm still young. I'm beautiful. Hey, I'm 27. But then I heard y'all talking, and I was like, I'm looking at Reagan and I'm looking at Joe. I'm like, yo, we old.
Yes.
We are so old.
How do you think I feel?
Especially when they're like, everyone was like, Herb is my teacher. I'm looking at them and I'm like, this is Dave, man. He was my dude. But this very building is actually where I started. I mean, I've been dancing my entire life. My siblings and I, we used to have our own little pretend house parties and pretend concerts and all that. So I've been dancing my entire life. But it wasn't until I got into high school, I was about 15, that I like got really into dancing. And I, you know, had big dreams about moving out to California and being like an awesome dancer and all that. And then just, you know, cultural upbringing, my mom was really against it. And then I did my own research, and then I found a beginning breakdance class at Xenon. And then, you know, me, not educated at the time, I thought breakdance was popping. And so I show up to the class and I meet Jason. And I was like, all right. I'm on the floor doing a six step. This is not what I expected. I expected to come in and be like, But, you know, anyway, fast forward, I meet Dave. But I don't know if you guys have ever seen Dancing Dave. The guy is mind-blowing. He's amazing, okay? Like, he is amazing. But of course, at the time, it was like me and Dave. We were like the only two people that were like really, really interested in popping here in Minnesota. But of course, when you got no skill and master level, Miss No Skill is like, I don't wanna dance. So I was actually really discouraged. It wasn't until Reagan and I went out to Breaking the Law out in Madison where I entered my very first popping battle that I got really serious about it. Fast forward years later, I end up meeting, our popping community grows, and I end up meeting these guys. When we performed in our first Rooted, we weren't officially crew yet, but I think it was after Rooted or shortly after Rooted, that's when we were like, man, we're homies, we're down, we practice together all the time, we're family, like we're crew, so. I'm old anyway. I'm gonna pass it on to, I'm actually gonna pass it on to Adam because I think he's gonna elaborate a little bit more on what I spoke on about us meeting at practice and stuff.
Cool, Adam.
Oh yeah, okay, for sure. So, falling on me. So there's a church in St. Paul called Central Mission Church. Shout outs to Pastor Ike and Pastor John, because for years, maybe even close to a decade, I don't know when the breaking session started, but they hosted a session there for breakers, and about 6-7 years ago now, there's another popper in the scene. His name is Chevelle, or Trusel now. He wanted to ask John about having a space for poppers to get down, because it was only breakers at the time, and I used to break more adamantly. So I went, and he couldn't commit to being there every week, though. So, but John gave us the space, you know, very gracious. And so every week, every Wednesday, for like 7 years now, we hold a popping session at Central Mission Church. So that's really the spot that, like, new people, you know, they hear about it. Like, everyone comes to practice. You know, there are those that are really, like, too far out of the way, and we recognize, you know, everybody that can't make it out to Central Mission that's part of the popping scene. But that's really sort of the hub for where the practice of funk styles goes on. Quick history of me, dancing my whole life. I got into popping roughly like right about that time, like 6-7 years ago. Who threw the meltdown? Okay. So Two-Psych, very prominent organizer and cultural advocate in the scene. So he threw meltdown, and completely randomly, you know, I started Usher, Michael Jackson, You Got Served, all the joints, right? And so then I see YouTube, you know, YouTube is like starting off, but you know, you see international dancers, and that's all where all my inspiration was originally. And not until I went to this jam called The Meltdown, it was the second iteration of the jam. The last iteration. I got to meet most of the people who are now in my crew, and Dave for the first time. Dave really is, he at one point, you know, that there was a time where he was the funk style scene. Dave, there's a piece that he entered for a contest, and in the spoken word piece that's talking about him, he was described as the sole proprietor of funk in the Midwest. And that is true. It is true. Like, he was the only one. So regardless of our beginnings, after getting into the scene, Dave has been an influence on all of us, on everyone who's been in the funk style scene. Guy's amazing. So, yeah, here we are all day. Pass it to who? All right, we're going on to what Godson has to say. Thanks.
Yes, Godson. Yes.
What up, y'all? Hey. So my name is Joseph James, AKA Godsent.
Mm-hmm. Keep on going.
All right then. Yes. So, brief history of all day. You hear the name, you know the crew, you see the faces. We're a bunch of fools. And it's true. But long story short, All Day came from a jam in Michigan. And Tracy was getting down, just roasting this OG in the cypher, in the battle, talking all this mess to her, and she just destroyed him. I'm in the background going, Minnesota all day, because Minnesota. I mean, it's our scene all day, you know. And from there, it was only me, Tracy, and Adam at that battle, but it was like a defining point of, like, we really want to get together and do something for our scene, do something for our funk style scene, because at the time, we were incredibly small. And we really wanted to grow. We were all hungry. We all wanted to go out and battle. And so a bunch of them went to Indiana for an event called Journey to the Center of the Cypher. And on the way back, they were like, you know, we should form a super crew, because I believe those two were in the finals. And semifinals? That was only a semifinal? Anyways. One of them ended up winning, I believe. I don't remember. I wasn't there, Adam. And they're like, we should form a Minnesota popping super crew that hasn't happened before because we're so small. B-boy scenes are so huge, and you know, we just got to represent. And they were like, let's call it All Day because of someone being ignorant in the background at a different band jam. And so they're like, cool. And they called everybody, put people down, and apparently I was one to get called. I don't know why. But and so that's what happened. Brief history on Godsent. So I started out in ballet, tap, and jazz. Doing musical theater. I still do a lot of it because it's my favorite thing. Tap is the greatest dance on the planet because, let's just be honest, it's tap dancing. It's rhythm, it's just rooted to the ground, making that beat. Locking is the second greatest, and then popping. They come whatever. But I am a locker, and I'm all about the funny. I'm all about the just spirit of the dance, just connected to the music, connected to the people. And that's what I believe dance is about. And within locking, there is no wrong moves. And that's what I think dance should be about. There is no wrong moves in dance. Everything you do every day is a dance, just without music. And so for me, dance is all about who you are, what you represent as a person, what you represent every day, your style of dress, your attitude. Marina's like, you have to go after that. I don't want to do this. So I'm going to leave it there and let her go.
Thank you. God sent. Melvina. Can you? There we go. Okay. All right.
I actually started off in sophomore of high school. I was just kind of watching music videos. You Got Served was the big movie that got me, like, I want to dance. Also, Jennifer Claus was one of the teachers at Egan High School that I was able to, like, going into, like, contemporary. I was going to ballet. I didn't really focus on it, but it was just, like, technique that I was able to pick up on there. And then it wasn't until there was a District 196 festival, and that's when I met Maia Maiden, and she kind of brushed up on... brushed up on hip hop, and I learned a little of, like, stomping there. And then it was junior in high school so I was going to school with Adam. That's where I kind of met. He kind of pulled me into the Minnesota funk style scene. Then that's when Central Mission kind of picked up. And then I didn't really dance. One, because I didn't know what popping was. So I just kind of watched, and it wasn't until Tracy started coming in and then kind of pulling me and then teaching me, and that's how I kind of, yes, she was very mean. She's like, there's not enough girls in the popping scene, you need to come out. I'm like, fine. And so I kind of, and then I think it was maybe a year or a half kind of into my dancing, is when I went to my first battle, and that was the Indiana trip. And being my first battle, it was very scary, because I wasn't really comfortable with popping. I kind of knew, like, the gist of it, but that was actually a good eye-opening, kind of to show me what I kind of needed to work on. But that's mine. And then, yeah, and after that, we all day kind of created. I kind of joined in randomly. I don't know why I was in it, to be honest, but They kind of pulled me in. That wasn't until I met Dancing Dave, and they kind of, they're my main focus, my main influence on how, on dancing and kind of working on my popping. So, yes.
Thank you, Melvina. All right.
Don't say that on camera. Okay. So my whole dance career pretty much started right after sixth grade. During that time, we didn't really have that much dancing styles to go off of, so everybody was learning dance moves. And I grew up on the east side of St. Paul, and over there is just a lot of Hmong people. And in our community, b-boying or breaking was a big, big part of our community. And so even if you go there now, there's a lot of Hmong b-boys throughout the whole city of St. Paul. And so dancing was definitely one of the things you wanted to do when you were younger. And I liked that style, but it wasn't something I wanted to do until you got served. Yeah. And so even then, we were just doing little dance moves here and there. I didn't like to dance on the ground, and so I didn't do the b-boy thing. And so I had to find another style to do, and I really wanted to be completely, like, engulfed in the dance world. And so I found popping. And back then, the ratio to, from poppers to breakers is like 1 to 20. So in every high school you go to, there's one popping crew and or one breaking crew, and it's usually like 10 or 20, 30 kids, and then there's one popper in the whole group. Yeah. And so being that, you literally battle that one other kid from the other school, and that's it. Yeah. So that's it. And then the actual scene itself was really small, and I didn't have much to kind of go off of, and it was really discouraging until YouTube came out. And that's when you start to, they started to record, people started to reconnect online, and that's actually where I found a lot of other poppers and in the St. Paul area, and tried to start crews with them first, and things didn't really work out, and we're all kids, and we didn't know how to connect past high school. And so since everybody's at different schools, there's no way to connect. And so it really wasn't until college was when I actually found Adam and one of our other crewmates, Chinu. And I didn't know that there was even a scene going on. And so after I found these guys, it really just kind of went through my mind that this could really happen. This whole dance movement could really happen, because at this point I was already super into it, just digging so deep into the history and trying to just be the best, but I had no one to dance with. And so once I found them, it became so real, and so now I don't even want to give it up. And we came up so small, and kind of going out, battling outside of Minnesota and seeing where everybody else is kind of almost mind-blowing. We're kind of small, but we grew so fast, and these guys are so talented. And I'm so happy that they're here, and I'm part of the little crew here, and it's so dope. Yeah, so
awesome.
Yeah, that's where we came from.
So there's only six of us in Rooted, but I want to give a shout out to the other four members of All Day. There's Chosen, Blindside, Coon, and Chief Funk that could not participate. All Day!
Last but not least.
Okay, so my name is Reagan Lee. My alias is Faceless Buddha. Unlike the rest of them, didn't start my music career in dance. I was a singer, actually. I didn't start dancing till high school, when on accident I ran into Dancing Dave, because my sister was actually friends with him. And so at the time, he was wanting to start an after school club. So he's like, hey, I need some people. Do you want to join this with me? And I was like, sure, I guess. Why not? Like, you know, you're a weird teenager. You don't know any better. So then I started dancing with him, and he was like, hey, here's some videos that I have of Mr. Wiggles, who's one of the pioneers from the East Coast, part of the Electric Boogaloos. So I started watching that. And then at that time, you know, Dave had left high school, and so I was kind of on my own. So I stopped dancing because I was doing my singing thing. So it wasn't until college when I started dancing again. And then I met Tracy at UMD. And so at the time, Tracy was a locker, and I was a popper. So then we kind of started fusing together, just doing funk styles thing, because we were dancing with some b-boys at the time at UMD. But it just, it's not the same, because they're breakdancing, and there's only two of us. So we had our own community, and they had their own, even though we were all hip-hop. But they didn't really understand us, and vice versa. So then Tracy came back down to the cities to pursue her education. Shortly I followed back and came back to the cities. There we formed another crew called Forgotten Elements, which was an all-styles crew at that time. And so we had, you know, poppers, b-boys, lockers, and house dancers at the time. And then we kind of grew apart, came back. And at that point, Tracy and I decided to invest back into the funk style scene because that's where our passions were. Luckily, we found other like-minded people. And as we were deciding to travel and do this seriously and say, hey, like, let's put Minnesota on the map, things kind of just fell apart. Together. Because then at that time, they had gone to Michigan. Months later, there was another battle in Indiana, and we were just deciding, hey, like, let's seriously do this together, which is where we came up with the all-day idea. At the time, we also made this inside joke of creating a clothesline, which there are brilliant ideas on this clothesline that we have yet to produce, but once we do, I promise you, buy the t-shirts. Yeah, and so that's, you know, and then we were invited again to the first Rooted. We weren't a crew then. At that time, we were just representing funk styles, dances, funk styles. But then, as the rest of the crew has said, you know, we've become close. And at this time, you know, we do represent our style of dance inside Minnesota. We give back to the community. We host something once a month called Each One Teach One, which is where at sessions, each person takes a turn teaching their expertise within the funk styles dance. And then we also host monthly battles where it's just to get practice and whatnot before we go off out of state to, you know, show what we can do. So where we like to say, you know, we are putting Minnesota on the map, we are also taking care of our own and trying to make sure that, you know, it's not just us that are continually growing, but the entire scene as a whole grows with us.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, All Day. So, up next, yes. See why I like them so much. So, yeah, that's important to say. A lot of times when I am looking for people to be in Rooted, I just put people together sometimes, okay? So, like they said, they were not a crew. They were not a group. I talked to Tracy, and I was like, I need poppers and lockers. That's your I need these people on stage because they had not been represented, and it was so crucial to me. And Tracy will tell you, like, I contacted her, and it was her job to get the rest of them because it needed to be seen. I was like, I don't have anybody besides Dance and Dave, and it was really small at the time. So I, of course, had Dance and Dave in the show a couple times, but I didn't have any women. And when I saw Tracy, I was like, yeah, you. I need you in the show. Yep, you. I'm going to take you. I said, but do you have anybody else? Because I want this people to know you guys are here. And so they were not a crew when I first approached her. They weren't. But here they are today, All Day. So next up, I have, where's Storm? Come on up here. Come on, let's keep it moving. Storm, Cyborg. Oh, that's my baby right there. David Jr. David Jr. is here. Who else? Oh, come on. Let's get in line, man. Get in line. Oh. No. Oh.
You're going to be A+.
Okay. So now these guys, not O, so he's kind of separate but equal. Stay right there. So these guys performed as Deadpool in Rooted 2016, and they have since, they're doing their own thing, doing multiple things, but they were in together as Deadpool, and then we had Cyborg on his own. So Cyborg, well, Cecil, which is Cyborg. So why don't you start us off?
All right. Hi, my name is Cecil Neal, a.k.a. Cyborg, a.k.a. Boy Caution, a.k.a. Virgo. I was born in Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada, and I moved up here. We were like going back and forth, but I like officially moved here when I was like 5. Got an apartment over in St. Paul. I basically started dancing. I've never been in like in a formal studio, like doing ballet or anything. I've always been in my basement. Thing that got me started was actually my cousin and I watched the Shark Tales movie in the car wash thing with the, you know, the do the hustle and all that. And my cousin was recording me, and she's just like, "You should do this." I'm like, "All right, bet." So ever since then, I started to watch even more movies. I was just like, I wasn't that too, but I saw You Just Got Served and then Stomp the Yard here and there. And then YouTube came along. I mean, I always watched different kinds of videos, but I saw this one crew called Dragon House. I mean, yes. I watched them mostly, who was a big person would be Nonstop, but I don't really watch them as much because they're not really, I just don't have time anymore. I don't. But one thing that I do want to thank and who like really brought me onto the scene, if anything else, would be my mom, Trini C. She got me into doing just dancing in public in general. I would have to say the first performance would have to be at my mom's Haiti fundraiser. And then I danced to Michael Jackson. He was also one of my inspirations. And then after that, I went to an open stage over at Stepping Stone, and I won first place there. And then after that, I did a really, I don't know what to call it, but it was a thing called Kid Icon Talent Show. And that's where I met those two over there, El Tawam. They were dope. I didn't know what to think. I was like, all right, well, I'm going to just be over here keeping to myself. But yeah, that's where, it wasn't like, I wasn't into the scene, but I was pretty much just like, noticing that there's not just me doing the hustle to Shark Tales, and and then after that I did my school talent show, 7th grade at Murray, and then that summer is where my mom, because of connections, made connections with me and Maia, and then I did my first Rooted. First Rooted was something special to me because first time I had to do anything formal, usually I would just like dance in front of my school, just like, oh yeah, you know, but I dance way different now, and I have expanded way different now. Doing choreography was something different because it would have to take time and regiment to make something and put something together rather than just doing something and might be sloppy, might not be sloppy, you don't know. After that, I was just like, wow, this is really cool. I met a whole bunch of people. I met like Mona Lisa, I met Herb, I met El Tawam again, and I was just like, you guys again. And I met, who else did I meet? El Toro, I met B-Boy Jason. Had a conversation about him and like what dancing meant to me and all, and like how he got started and stuff. And that's when, after that, I did Being Brothers and Sister Solo in my, oh wait, no, I went to, I went to high school. Yeah, I went to high school and I took,
Cause man, what grade are you in now? Cause
I'm in 11th grade.
He's in 11th grade. That's what I'm telling you. That's the talent that he is trying to portray to you. Like he's been doing this for since birth. I'm liking it though. I really like what you're laying out. It's really in depth. Thank you. Yes.
No problem.
So you in high school now, and you go to
St. Paul Conservatory Performing Artists.
There you go. Yes.
No, it was my 9th grade year where I did Being Brothers and Sister Solo.
Yeah.
I was the youngest on the cast list. I'm very grateful because that's another opportunity to show my talents and what I can do and be more in-depth into the hip-hop scene. And then after that, I just danced with my friends at school, danced with Herb, and where I met Ray, Mia, my friends Jaquise and Monzea, and then this last Rooted, coming off of my 10th grade year, was something, it's like where I felt like I made a statement because it's like, I felt like it would be like the very first standpoint where I had a lot of styles that I could actually do and not just like, just say that I do it, but I don't really show it. So I showed my palette there and then eventually just branched off into like doing my own thing. And then I took on Crump under Herb. And then I made my own crew called Kasai. And now we had a performance over at Victoria Theater. And that's basically where I'm at right now. I'm looking for the next big thing, so.
Awesome. Thank you, Cisa. Up next, David Jr. Come on, tell us about yourself. How did you get into the hip hop scene?
Hello. I'm not that prepared, but my name's David Jr. And I've been dancing for about 4 or 5 years. I'm self-taught. I started, I think, in the summer of sophomore year. In terms of what inspires me, there's a lot of things that inspire me. Like, honestly, like everyone I'm around sort of inspires me. Like, the smallest things, like it could even be like hair could inspire me and like make concepts out of that. But I'd probably say my biggest inspiration is probably my little brother. He's actually autistic and I've always wanted a little brother ever since I was like little. And when he was born, it was just, it was a good feeling. So he inspires me a lot. He's also one of the reasons I started dancing because he would be, I don't know if anyone knows like That's So Raven, but the theme song would come on and he'd just be jumping around and I would just hop in too. So it was just, it was just a lot of good moments with him. And that's one of my biggest inspirations is my little brother. He's 11 or 12 right now. Yeah, he's 12. And I got into Deadpool kind of randomly because Herb kind of just, I guess he just hit me up to go to a session. And I guess he's seen something in me or something. Because when I dance, I try to have fun, kind of like the same feeling I have when I'm with my brother. I just have fun. You know, I don't really worry about impressing anyone or anything like that. I just go out there and just do me. And I guess people like it. And yeah, I don't know what else to talk about.
Yeah. And David is the most winningest champion of any battle that goes on in Minnesota. He has got a lot of battles under his belt, so he may be acting this way right now, but he is a force to be reckoned with. So thank you, David. Thank you so
much. Thank you.
Storm, come on, man. Tell us about yourself. How'd you get into the hip hop community here in Minnesota?
What's up? I'm Storm. That's my real name, not my stage name.
That is his real name.
Man, I wish I could say I've been dancing for like my whole life, like everybody else, but I started like almost 4 years ago. Like, oh, I've been dancing since I was in the womb. Man, not this guy. No, but I moved here to Minnesota in 2009 and came here from California. I didn't have any friends or anything because that was my first year of high school. So I started freshman year just a loner. I had really nothing to do. And I got into gymnastics. I started doing gymnastics like a lot. Like I was in gymnastics for 4 years straight. And I was actually, I was in this hip hop choreography crew when I was, when I think I was like a junior. And I didn't never danced my entire life. And I joined this crew called Lunchbox. And I was just a guy in the background who couldn't do any of the moves, but I can do flips. So like they would have me go out and we'd be doing the whole thing and I'd be in the back and I'd be like, all right, boom, flip. And like that was my thing. And then I would, you know, talk to the girls like, yeah, I'm in a dance crew, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm the flippy guy, you know? And I never really took dance seriously. Like, you know, I've seen all the movies too, like You Got Served and Step Up. And I don't know, I wasn't really moved by it until I saw it in real life, you know? Like it's way different in real life. Like it's like, whoa, this is legit. But no, and then so, you know, throughout high school, I didn't really dance. I just, you know, did flips in the back of a hip hop choreography crew. And then I went to Central Mission, which some of the guys from All Day were talking about. And it's funny too, cause like I started breakdancing and I had never seen any of these guys or anything. Cause I was breakdancing for like 3 years or no, 2 years before I met any of these guys. And it's all hip hop, but it's like, it's funny how the B-boys are in their own different world and like all the other dancers in a whole different world. And so I went to a breakdance like battle, or there it was like a, it was, I think it was Uprising 2 I went to, and Herb is the one who puts on Uprising. It's like a crump slash all-style slash b-boy battle. And I just was going to every b-boy battle because I was trying to be serious about it. And I'm like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to be so cool. And then, and so I heard Uprising, they were having a b-boy part of it. And I was like, all right, cool, I'm down. You know, b-boys, you know, it's kind of sad. We don't really show any love to, like, the all-styles, you know, community. Because whenever we throw jams, it's all b-boy, you know. So, like, when I've been doing that, and I haven't seen anything else. So then when her put on his thing and included b-boys, I thought that was really cool. So, you know, I went, I competed, I lost, I think. I don't remember what happened. But afterwards, I went up to Herb, and I told him, like, yo, I appreciate you including b-boys in your whole thing, because, you know, we don't do that for you guys, so you don't really have to do that for us. But, you know, I thought that was great. And he was like, oh, yeah, you know, showing all, you know, everybody knows Herb, you know, he's just cool. And he invited me to go to a session at his house. And so I went to the session, and I met, like, some people over there. I think you were there, and, no, that guy was there. And I was like, man, like, and it was my first time seeing, like, anything else besides b-boying. And I was just like, man, this is really cool. Man, I want to do this. I don't, but I want to. And then afterwards, Herb asked me to do, like, a performance at the State Fair with him and a bunch of other people, too. And I thought that was, like, super cool. So I went, I did that. And then, I've kind of just been doing the b-boy thing, going to battles, traveling, competing, and things like that. And while also on the side, trying to learn from guys like these, you know, different styles, like, you know, crump and popping and everything. I'm nowhere near, like, these guys' level, but they're really inspiring, and that's kind of my whole thing in the hip-hop community, so.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you, Storm. Next up, not a part of Deadpool, but a definite inspiration in terms of one of the leaders of the Crump movement in Minnesota. Oh, he's going to tell you his whole name. So, yeah, you're going to say the whole thing. Say the whole thing. All right, here we go. Oh.
Hello. So my real name is Ololode Bademosi, but I go by O. So I've been dancing my whole life as well. I actually started dancing in the living room with my dad watching a Nigerian artist by the name of Barista. And the thing about him that inspired me to dance like him was he would have the traditional Nigerian wear called agbada, and he'd put it over, it's like a big cape. So what I'd do when I was younger is I'd go in the bathroom, get like the colorfulest towel I would ever seen, put it around myself and dance in front of my dad. And I kind of regret telling that story now, but after that, you know, my biggest inspirations were Michael Jackson. He was a big one of them, you know. And I would say that after that, I kind of stopped dancing when I got into elementary school, and then I kind of picked it up in 06 because around that time, YouTube was starting to be big. And I noticed a dancer by the name of Tie-Dyes. And Tie-Dyes was the creator of Crump, so he made me wanted to look more into it. And I started looking at different crumpers, and I probably just sessioned by myself in the basement. Around 2012 is when I actually reached out to the Crump movement here in Minnesota. It was actually a funny story because I posted that I wish there was Crumpers in Minnesota on a Crump page. And then a person by the name of Devonce, AKA Hostiles, he reached out to me and told me to come to a church up in North Minneapolis. And there was a whole bunch of Crumpers there, so they sessioned and I watched. But I would have to say that around 2013, we hosted our first event, The Uprising, and it was me, Herb, a guy named Toe, Devonce. And the first one, it wasn't as successful as we thought it was because we wanted to promote Crump in a positive way. But we didn't get enough Crumpers to come, and a lot of people weren't really into the movement like we were into the movement. So then Herb hit me up one day. He was like, yo, are you really trying to like put on for the movement? And I was like, yeah. I was like, all right, let's do The Uprising 2. I was like, all right, just me and you? He was like, yeah, just me and you. So we did The Uprising 2, and that was better than the first one. And then around, I think it was, yeah, December, Herb was talking to me about traveling to an event in Colorado called Absolute Zero, where we would meet a whole bunch of Crumpers and we would battle. I battled, I got past the preliminary rounds, which is shocking to me, but then I had to battle somebody who's been in Crump for the past 10 years and he destroyed me on the dance floor. So I was like, oh, okay, I don't know about this. But then, you know, it leaded up to us actually like learning because we took workshops there and then we came back here. And then in March, we went to Kansas City for an event called March Buck Madness, where we went with a whole bunch of other people from Minnesota to show that, you know, Crump isn't just about, you know, flailing your arms or looking like you're fighting somebody that's not there. It's all about your imagination and inspiration of what makes you want to be there. And I would assume that everybody that went, they enjoyed it, they liked it. So around that time, I think it was July, Maia Maiden reached out to me and said, I want you to be in the Rooted piece for a Crumper salute. I was like, all right, cool. And I think around that time, that's when the Crump movement started spiking because before we got there, we had a session and this guy called me out to battle me. And usually when I dance, I don't focus on everybody, but when I was watching Cecil dance, I looked and everybody was watching and I felt like, oh, maybe everybody has an interest in Crump. So, you know, I think people enjoyed me and Cecil's battle. They enjoyed our Crumper salute. And then we had the Uprising 3. And I think we had a lot more people from Minnesota that was learning Crump in there actually be in the tournament. And we had our first ever female winner of the Uprising tournament. And it was really good. So, you know, yeah, that's it.
Thank you, O. Thank you. Okay, last but not least, these stories are really inspirational. A lot of people that everybody's saying has been in Rooted before, like he talked about Devonce. He has been in Rooted, I want to say, 2012 or so. And so, like I said, they do a recircling. But last but not least, we are going to call up A+, and everybody in the A plus crew that was in Rooted. So we're gonna hear a little bit about them. A plus, can you start us off, please? And thank you.
How y'all doing? Good. Y'all still awake over here? Y'all real quiet and looking like. I go by Alan Muir. That's my actual name. I also go by A plus, and also known as the Immortal. The current leader of Immortal Dance Team, lead choreographer for Legacy Live Entertainment, tribute to the King of Pop, and also a choreographer for Shapeshift Dance Company. To start off my journey as far as with hip hop, I was 3 years old, and first time I've experienced hip hop, I was in front of a TV at, I don't even remember whose house we were, but all I know is Crisscross Jump was on there, and I was amazed. I just couldn't stop jumping. And so from there, I was like, just all about hip hop from there, like on the inside. So fast forwarding, you know, some people just have the natural groove. And so like I've grown up around hip hop and R&B music. My mom used to listen to a lot of Janet Jackson and stuff like that. My dad used to listen to pretty much any hip hop artist that was really prevalent in the 90s, from E-40 to Tupac, to Snoop Dogg, the whole, you know, West Side crew. Anybody you could think of, Spice One, and you also used to listen to a lot of old school, like the Spinners and all that type of stuff, African Bambaataa. So I've been surrounded by that type of music, and then all the older generation of my family, they were very influenced, and they loved to watch and listen to Michael Jackson, and so thus my journey began, because as soon as I saw Michael on stage, it was magic. It was a done deal. From that point on, I knew I wanted to dance. And fast forward now, going into high school, which is when I start actually doing, you know, formative dancing, like actually doing choreography and stuff like that. I remember seeing a bunch of students paying tribute to Britney Spears my freshman year of high school. And I was like, oh, this is really awesome. They're doing a production, which stemmed from somebody else doing a production 4 years prior to. And the year after that, they decided to put a Leah tribute concert together. And they had auditions for a Missy Elliott and Genuine mix that they were putting together. And I was like, you know what? I don't do nothing else. I don't play no sports. And I wanted to play sports, but I was told not to play sports because I'm too little. So I'm going to do something else. They told me to be spunky. So I went and auditioned for that because I always loved dance and art and just performing. So I auditioned for that, and they took a liking to me very well. It made me very welcome, and that was at Central High School, by the way. Central High School graduate, appreciate that. So with that being said, I did well in that, and then because of that, they wanted me in the main cast of the Illyria Tribute Concert and performed that, and it was amazing. And then from there, that summer, became friends with a group of people in that production, and they decided that they were gonna take over the next year of high school for the hip hop program that was at our high school. And I don't know why they decided to have me join along with it, because I had never been involved with none of the organizations in that school, but they were like, brought me along with me, and they gave me a ranking, so they made me like a co-captain. And so from there, I just was like, became a co-captain. And the year after that, my senior year, I became the captain. And then after that, I became a coach. And up to that point, I was just dancing in high school, and then a mentor of mine, his name was Levi Martin. He had came in to one of the auditions that I was doing, and he seen me, and he was like, you, I need to talk to you. And he was like, I have this dance group called Immortal. And what was funny is, when I was growing up, if you're from St. Paul, everybody knows who Immortal and the Half Pints are. That's a very prevalent drill team and dance team that came from another drill team called African Perfection that was uplifting our African black folks in the Rondo community after it got torn up by the freeway of I-94. So with that being said, he said, yeah, I want you to come dance with me. And then I became part of Immortal, and I had to drop out because I had to put on my own concert where I was paying tribute to Usher my junior and senior year. And then I came back finally, and I danced with him for about a year and a half. And life is so funny because right at the tail end of me meeting him, he said, I want to focus on my music career. so I'm gonna pass this down to you. So he passed what now is a 20-year legacy to me, somebody that just got out of high school. And I'm like, I don't know how to lead. I don't lead anything. I go to school and I follow. I'm a worker bee. I don't do this type of stuff. But with that being said, he believed in me and he passed the torch to me. And then because of that, I got to know other people in the dance community, and I ran into Dancing Dave and, you know, had a few sessions with him, not even just impromptu stuff. Like, we would see each other at the State Fair at the B96 booth and just start getting it in. Stuff like that, and from there, I just kept dancing, and you know, becoming the leader of Immortal, you learn about other crews, and then, you know, you run into other crews at other competitions, and then I ran into Herb and Josh Stevens, and you know, that rivalry started because, you know, it's Minneapolis versus St. Paul, and you know, oh, we're better than you, we're better than you, but it's all still love at the end of the day. So from there, you know, I just kept getting inspired and learning about other dancers that are here in the Twin Cities and knowing that it's not just about St. Paul and it's not just about Minneapolis. There's dancers everywhere. You just have to find them, but you have to open yourself up to that. And here we are now. Because I did that, I became part of the Michael Jackson tribute concert and meeting other people through there and performing through there and pulling my way up through the years and becoming the, you know, assistant choreographer, then lead choreographer. And now I'm able to meet more people. And because of that, people like Maia Maiden, which I didn't know about, but I feel really bad because I'm like, that's somebody that's really prevalent in this community and that I should know about. But she knew about me and she studied me. And I really appreciate that. And that's much respected because a lot of people don't, you know, do their research or get to know what's out there. You basically just take hip-hop for face value of what's put on TV. But she looked in and saw what I was doing with my community, within myself, and those under me, and she wanted me to be a part of her production called Sister Solo Bring Brothers. And that was the first time I got to perform on a stage and know what Maia was about and what she was trying to do, and I'm like, this is really dope, and I like what she's got going on in here. And as well as I've heard, you know, her reputation of being hard on people, I understand why she's hard on people. No, true story. But I understand because it's like, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything, you know? And so like, we have to take what we have of hip hop because it's so strong and it got us through so many years of oppression and everything like that. We have to stand strong with that, and we have to build communities and platforms so it can really be seen and not watered down for dollars. You know what I mean? And so with her doing that, I caught wind of that, and I started to find my purpose, and then I started dancing with all these beautiful young people right here, and you know, just being inspired by them. I'm inspired by so many people, by the way, just from everybody that was before me, and even to people that are behind me that are coming up. Like, I'm never too cool or never too old, you know, to say I respect them and that I follow them and that they inspire me, because they always do. And here we are, Maia seen us do a project where we were working on a cypher, a first time ever cypher where you're supposed to have rappers and dancers cyphering at the same time. I was called the New Wave, and she picked up on it. Somebody sent out a video, like a little snippet of what we were doing. We haven't even put it out yet. And she was like, hey, Immortal, Alan, I need you and I need all of them. I don't care how you make it happen, just make it happen. And I was like, you got it. Sir, Mr. Dean Kane, sir, you got it. So here we are, and I'm blessed to be here, and I'm glad that we're a part of this community. I'm glad that we're part of such a historic day, and I don't know, like, I think it's really wonderful that she's created this platform where we can get nominated for SAGE Awards and stuff like that, because we wouldn't even have an opportunity if it wasn't for people like her fighting in her everyday life for us to be prevalent and for us to have a voice and for our movement to be seen and not stolen. So thank you again. That's my story and how I came about in the hip-hop community. Here I am, and I hope to continue to be and keep helping these people grow. And I know this one right here, like, I wish he would stop talking right now.
Thank you, Alec. Mimi, right, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay. Yeah, I'll try to control myself. I could talk forever. Okay, where do I begin? My name's Mimi. Mimi Rokemore. My full name is Monique, but I've been called Mimi for as long as I can remember. I actually started dancing in a Mexican like folk collection kind of called Los Alegres Bailadores, the west side of St. Paul. Of Cesar Chavez, like where the whole Latino community is. Mm. Yeah, shout out. I was forced into it, so likely I quit once I actually had the decision to. But other than that, I was always surrounded by hip hop. My dad listened to a lot of gangster rap, and my mom listened to a lot of soul. One album that really influenced me was Miseducation of Lauryn Hill. And I just felt like she just like sang my whole life and I didn't even know it. And it was like, I was so young and I didn't even realize like that there was a reason I was connecting to it so profoundly. And like listening to it as I grow older, I find new reasons to love it like every time I listen to it. Other than that, also the Fugees, like anything, I just didn't even realize that I was being influenced and surrounded by a hip hop lifestyle stemmed from my parents and like what their lifestyle was. But I kind of like accidentally fell into doing hip hop or dancing hip hop anyways. I originally wanted to go to SPCPA like a lot of everybody else went. I wanted to go there for the vocal track, but it was actually filled up. And so my mom was like, well, they said you can go for dance. That's the only thing they had open. I'd never did hip hop dance before. Like I Googled things and tried them in my room. And other than that, I'd never done it like in front of people. I went to the audition in jeans and a t-shirt. To the ballet audition, it was like the most embarrassing thing I've ever done in my life. And now I just like, I'm so glad nobody was videotaping that. So embarrassing. But I ended up going to the dance track and they were like, after a semester, if you want, you can transfer to the vocal track. I took my first hip hop class with Amira Sackett and I was hooked. Not because I was good, because I was really bad, but I was hooked on it because it was the like one of the most challenging things I've ever done. But like the fact that she could move her body like that and have so much control doing it, and then on top of that, she was a woman doing it, I was just like, I'm gonna do that, and I'm gonna be bomb at it. She took an interest in me and she kind of helped me as best as she could. And I also sought out different places like what All Day was talking about, Central Mission. I would go there and it's funny that Tracy said how she was mean to Malvina. She was never mean to me, but it was really intimidating. It was a very male dominated scene, especially with all the break dancers. There was the only woman that I knew of was Tina and Mona Lisa for breakers, and Tracy for popping, and I don't know, I was very self-conscious and insecure and uncomfortable, and I was determined to get rid of that and to just, you know, confront myself on that fear because of how much I loved it. You know, it wasn't worth it to, like, hold myself back. During high school, I got in touch with Darian Reese. He now lives in LA. He was in Deadpool and he was like, you're tight, you should come audition. At the same time, actually, Kanan was auditioning, or he was in Immortal already, almost like the same week. They were like, you should come audition for Immortal. And then I ended up missing the bus there, and I was just chilling after school, and Darian's like, come audition for Deadpool. And so like, if I would have not missed that bus, I would have danced with Alan a long time ago. It would have been a whole different, yeah. But I ended up going there, and like I danced for them, and they were like, okay, let's huddle. And they like all huddled in front of me. It was me and then this other girl named Nikila. And it was like Herb, Lulu, Reese, Rock. And they were all like, okay, well, you're in and you have no choice. And so I was like, okay, I guess. And I started dancing with them for a little while, a couple years. What I got from that was a sense of just like, not in a bad way, that I don't that it didn't matter if I was a girl or a guy. Like, if I came to practice, I was freestyling and in front of everybody. And it got to the point where it was a standard. It was habitual. Like, I didn't feel nervous to do it. It just was something that we did. And it wasn't like they were giving me props because I was a girl. It was like they were giving me props because, like, oh, you're growing from the last time I saw you or from the last, from when you started. And so I got that sense of just like habitually being able to dance and express myself, and it was liberating, and it was also, you know, just freeing. And after that, in high school, you know, I did ballet, West African. Miss Kenna was like the most scary teacher I ever had, but she also like she like had me gyrating on the ground. I had no clue like how to move my body like that. but she was like one of the most, and her, Tony, Yuri, when I started going to two, were the most influential teachers I probably ever had, just because I'd never take away just movement from their classes. I'd take away something for myself and something that I can build on consciously and physically. Other than that, I started taking ballet, and I realized that I can use my femininity and not suppress that the way that I kind of felt like I had to dancing around guys. I felt like I couldn't, like, you know, be open with my, you know, sexuality, and like I just had to be, you know, a girl pretending to be like a guy, pretending I knew what I was doing, you know. And so with ballet, it like made me think of hip hop in another approach. Like, I can use that to my advantage. And it also made me like realize a lot of the things that I saw wrong in my community and like in the internet community when it came to hip hop and women and sexism. And right now I'm studying feminist philosophy and communications in college, and a lot of things that I've had a problem with, now I can actually give names to them. And it's making it so much more easy to know how to go about, you know, fixing this thing that is mine, this thing that I feel like at some points in my life, a lot of people have tried to take away from me, but it wasn't really them. It was just more of my perspective on it. So, at this point, my whole goal is just to make sure, like, no girl, I guess guy too, but mostly girls, just because it's such a male-dominated scene, has to ever feel like uncomfortable or feel like they can't voice anything or express themselves or experiment with anything. Shout out to the twins for being you. And I'm inspired by everybody. Like, I love everybody so much. And yeah, I love hip hop. It's my life. That's the end. Okay, I'm done.
Thank you, Mimi. Lydia?
Okay. Sorry, I'm short. Yeah, I think that's good. I'm not that short, Alan. Okay. Hi, I'm Lydia Jones. So I started dancing in my house with my sister. She went to Main Street, and she did swing dancing there. So she would come home, and she would teach me swing dancing. And then I didn't want to go to a main school, high school. So then my brother went to St. Paul Conservatory for performing arts. So I wanted to continue to learn how to dance. So I went there not knowing anything about dance. And when I got there, someone who's not here, her name is Jeanne Jackson, we stood next to each other and we were like, how do you do any of this? So we were sitting there making a fool of ourselves, joking around, and then my first hip hop teacher was Amira Sackett, and just visualizing a female who was so powerful and being able to move her body and be confident about it inspired me to continue to learn how to dance. So then I learned African from Kenna, and then I continued with that. I love African, so then I ended up taking some African classes outside of that and doing drumming and drum circles, and then Herb was a teacher there, so then I started to learn with him, and ended up at my senior year of high school, I was like, Herb, you're only teaching crump, do you want to teach like one more like choreography of not crump so I can expand, because I don't think I'll dance after high school. He's like, why would you ever stop dancing? That's a stupid idea. So then he invited me over to his house, and I learned, and I met a gazillion people there, and he started teaching me house, and I started sessioning with him and learning from him, and then I met Alan. He became my mentor, and so then we started doing work, and he started teaching me
some choreography for a video by the woman of name of Anjani. She's from Trinidad. So then we started working with her and started doing movement. And then the New Wave group that he was talking about, we did the video for that, and that was really fun. It was something that I'd never done before, so we were working with these people doing music on top of dance and then building myself in the hip-hop community of something that I never thought I'd be a part of. And then Maia Maiden wanted us to do that. And we got there, I remember, we had done the tech rehearsal, and she was like, I love you guys and I love the video, but we need the energy like that. You gotta get it. And so that pushed us, and we grew and grew, and just not even realizing that something like this could bring us to being nominated for a stage award is beautiful to me. And it just all happened because I started really engaging myself in the hip hop community about a year ago last month. So it's just been a year for me, but it's been eventful and I love it. And there's something that I never want to give up. So yeah.
Awesome, Lydia. Ray.
Oh, Lord. My stomach hurting.
You gotta like all the way up, all the way up. Okay, my name is Rafael Lorenz Dow III, AKA Kid Caution, AKA El Trey, otherwise known as Ray. So, my life story. My mom birthed me. She said my feet smell like Fritos. And once she realized that these Frito-smelling feet had rhythm, she got me a drum set. I'm not a musician. I am a musician. But she got me a drum set. I did that just kind of as a kid thing because I'm a little baby, so I was just messing around with it. But then she sat me down in front of Breaking 2, Electric Boogaloo, and I had been doing the moves. I was like, into the thing that they had on the thing, and then I was doing the breaking parts, and then she realized that she needed to get me into some dance movements, so she put me into this dance thing where I started kind of just doing flips and turns and taps, and then we had a performance that was very glittery and sparkly, and I was like, y'all, this is not for me. And then this is the thing, I had to quit because they said they had a hip-hop class, and once they started doing leaps, I'm like, that's not hip hop. I was crying outside of the window, and my mom had to take me home because I was crying so bad. After that, I was like, I'm out for myself. I gotta watch YouTube. Thank God YouTube existed. Just watching YouTube, watching Breaking, Beat Street, just all of that stuff, and just like doing the best I could as to pick up on what they were showing, and like learning what I really was interested in instead of just other dances. And then my mom finally said she had found me a place to dance. She tricked me because I assumed it was hip hop. It wasn't. She brought me to two dance and I saw them doing ballet in tights. And I was like, what is this? And I tried to leave. She had brought me back. I met Tony and Yuri Sands. They were like very convincing. They was like, just try it. You never know what you can do. And then I ended up loving it. I ended up taking their ballet, Modern West African, with Miss Kenna Cotman. I got introduced to that. And then when she would leave, I met Tomiko French. She introduced me to Postmodern. And then a few years later, once I got into high school, I met Herbert Johnson, who was my hip hop teacher, taught me how to do other things besides popping and waving within like the dubstep genre. He was teaching house that year or that semester. And that's what really got me into keeping with other styles in hip hop, not necessarily knowing a very broad ranged side of hip hop, but like knowing that there was other styles besides popping, breaking. Like he brought me into the other world of like Chicago style footwork and just housing, and that's kind of what I do now. Not mainly, I'm lying, because I do crump and other things. Footwork is something I think is really cool, and I'm just really interested in it right now. So that is how I got into with Herbert, and then a couple months later, he told me to come to a session. And kind of just started teaching me things. I never had been to a session before with other people who could dance well. So that was interesting. And then we had a thing called J-Term at school, which put me into a West African performance with Whitley McCluskey, yes. And then we had done the JTRA performance, and then afterwards she had asked a few of the kids from her cast to come perform with her outside, and that's where Alan said he had saw me at a banquet dinner. And then I ended up living in the same apartment complex with him at the Schmidt Artist Loss, and we exchanged many awkward looks through the hallways. He has this like very stern, serious face all the time, which made me a little scared of him. But we said hi like twice before we finally talked. And we just started kind of like talking, and like he asked me to do a project with him, which ended up being the new wave thing, and just kind of brought all of us together and to do this amazing project with amazing camera work and awesome choreography that they have a clip of on and won't put out the video. And then Maia Maiden said she had seen it. The first time I didn't necessarily meet Maia, but I had saw her because I was at the Uprising 2 competing in the All Styles battle. And she was one of the MCs. She was one of the MCs. I thought she was super funny, super cool. And the first time I officially met her was when I was a part of, me and Deadpool were doing our thing for Rooted, and she came to my apartment complex to see us and collect some info. And I went up to her and introduced myself, because everybody was talking about her like, oh my God, she's this, she's that, like, she's amazing, she's stern, so be serious and be on your best behavior. And I was like, okay. And like, literally, like, I felt so like ashamed of myself when the whole Deadpool, Herbert, Storms, David, Cecil, they're like, you don't know who Maia Maiden is? And I was like, no, I just felt like, have you ever seen Sandlot and they get mad at him because he doesn't know who Babe Ruth is? Like, that's how it was for me. So I had been a part of this project and that project at the same time collectively, and had performed with Deadpool and performed with A-plus and crew. Oh, for Rooted, which was an amazing experience. It was crazy for me. It's one of the things that has me really deeply diverse in the hip-hop community with all my connections now. Maya has recently reached out to me to do Solo Sisters and Being Brothers. I think that's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be great. I got really nervous when I was reading the email. And basically from there, that's my life story. I'm done now.
Thank you. We talked, I'm Mia Johnson, but I also have to shout out 2Dance, because I didn't talk about that because I got on a little tangent, and 2Dance has helped me a lot as well in having West African with Miss Kenna and learning from Tony and Yuri, and I had to
awesome.
Shout them out.
And Ray and Mia, are you guys in high school?
Yeah, juniors.
Yes, juniors in high school. Yes. Good. He's got plans. Okay, Michelle. Yes, so I think I got everybody. Yep, I'll make sure I got everybody. So, yes, thank you. And I'm going to pass it back to Michelle. Here you go.
You guys are lovely. Thank you. I feel like I should be a high school teacher and dismissing, right, the youngsters. Unbelievable stories. And I just want to thank our sponsor, the Performing Arts Archives at the University of Minnesota Libraries. Also, my group of advisors, Cecily Marcus, Kate Weecha, Linda Shapiro, Nancy Mason Hauser, and Judith Brent Ingber for their help in putting together this series. And then especially Maia Maiden for rallying your crews together to get all those stories. It's really critical that we fill this gap that is in our dance history and make sure that everybody is counted.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Thanks, everybody.
Write his quote. Write your name on there, because the O is not going to be.
You might want to write it up here.
Great.
O-L-O. Uh-huh. L-A-D-E. Last name is G-B-A-D-A-L-E.
MOSI.
Great, thank you so much. I write down every time someone said YouTube and Michael Jackson and you got served. So
yes.
All of those, look at this, it's so funny. It's like YouTube.
Michael Jackson, YouTube. You got served.
Michael Jackson, you got served.
Herb.
Next to you
and Maia. Maia.
Herb, yes.
Yeah. Right, Miss Kenna.
I think you got, yeah.
Oh,